Today's webinar is also hosted by the Great Northern LCC Rocky Mountain Partner Forum, which is one of four forums within the Great Northern LCC geography. The Rocky Mountain Partner Forum is an international network of conservation practitioners working to connect their efforts and achieve landscape-level conservation of natural resources and processes in the Rocky Mountains. For information about the forum, please visit their website. The URL is at the bottom of the slide that it's currently showing. It is rmpf.weebly.com. I would now like to introduce our speakers who are all with the Yellowstone to Yukon Initiative. Kim Trotter is the U.S. Program Director, is based in Driggs, Idaho, brings more than two decades of on-the-ground conservation work to Y2Y as a conservation advocate and coalition builder. Kim has extensive experience in private land conservation, stream restoration, and environmental policy. Lacy Robinson, Cabinet-Purcell Mountain Coordinator Project Coordinator, is a wildlife biologist who has studied Canada lynx, snowshoe hares, and many carnivore species. In 2010, Lacy co-created the Multi-Species Baseline Initiative, which is a five-year collaborative project to determine the status and distribution of 200 species of wildlife across 23,000 square kilometer study area centered on the Idaho Panhandle. Lacy now coordinates Y2Y's collaborative efforts in the Cabinet-Purcell Mountain Corridor. And lastly, Candace Batycki, Program Director, British Columbia and Yukon, has more than 25 years conservation advocacy experience, with a focus on protecting ecosystems for threatened and endangered wildlife. Candace has worked on campaigns to protect marine ecosystems, grizzly bears, and forest protection, including protection of 2 million hectares of mountain caribou habitat in the inland temperate rainforests of British Columbia. Welcome, Kim, Lacy, and Candace.
Thank you so much, Mary, for the very warm welcome, and thanks to the Great Northern Landscape Conservation Cooperative and the Rocky Mountain Partner Forum for hosting our conversation today about the Cabinet-Purcell Mountain Corridor. Currently, there are two of us online. Unfortunately, Candace is struggling to get on the phone right now, so we might just have the two of us, which we're definitely very U.S.-centric without Candace present, but we will adjust until she gets on board. Lacy, recently, I wanted to just give a little background of Lacy. She's our new Cabinet-Purcell Mountain Corridor Project Coordinator. She joined us in June and has been doing a great job leading the collaborative from standpoint. And the way that we'll go through the presentation today, and first of all, Lacy is also controlling all of the dials today, so you can go ahead and switch the slide next. The way that we've organized our presentation today is based on how we have moved forward in the Cabinet-Purcell Mountain Corridor Collaborative. And it's a mouthful to say the Cabinet-Purcell Mountain Corridor. So you'll see throughout these slides, we call it the CPMC. And it's not a very great name for a really good partnership. But the way that we've really set up this partnership is similar to almost any other adaptive management model that used to be out there, where we evaluated the current conditions and the desired conditions and moved forward in our partnership to define goals, actions, and then to begin implementing projects. But then we have gone back to monitor to decide what our next steps are. All of this being with the partnership and working with our partners throughout this region to move the partnership forward and to, of course, affect on-the-ground conservation. So you'll see this slide quite a few times throughout this presentation. Next. So we couldn't do any of this without the support of many, many partners and specifically many funders. We've been working in the Cabinet-Purcell Mountain Corridor for over 10 years, and it's only possible through the support of many of our funders, including the Wilbur Forest Foundation and the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation, who have specifically funded work in building this collaborative. Next. So we're going to start at the big scale. The Yellowstone-Yukon Conservation Initiative was really formed when we looked at grizzly bear distribution, about 50 to 70% of the Yellowstone Yukon Conservation Initiative service area is managed for grizzly bear, for grizzly bears in both Canada and the United States. And our mission is to conserve and protect habitat, or connect and protect habitat from Yellowstone to the Yukon, so people and nature can thrive. And while the grizzly bear next while the grizzly bear is often used as our focal species, we use the grizzly bear because, in general, where grizzly bears are present, about 80% of all other species are present and habitat is intact. Next. Historically, grizzly bears roamed most of the United States and Canada. They went well beyond the Missouri River or the Mississippi River. And we've seen over time that that grizzly bear habitat has diminished tremendously. And so distribution of grizzly bears, where we used to have grizzlies in California and Colorado as recently as the 1940s, now we only have the Yellowstone population left, and then three transboundary populations. And when we talk transboundary, we're talking about between Montana, Idaho, and Alberta and British Columbia, between the U.S. And Canada. And we often use grizzly bears also as a metric because this is how we define wildness. And this is a species that once roamed most of the western U.S. and now has only very limited healthy population. Next. So in this process, biologists were talking and we were getting together, this is well before my time, but we were talking about what's happening with grizzly bears and how these populations were turning from peninsulas into islands. It really was very clear that we needed a bigger strategy. Next. Grizzly bear biologists have been working with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service and other transboundary projects have known for years that what we needed to do is connect these grizzly bear populations. We've got the Greater Yellowstone Ecosystem grizzly bear population, the Northern Continental Divide Ecosystem population, and then two populations in the Selkirks and also the Cabinet Yak Recovery Zone. But right now, as you can see in the middle of this slide, the salmon cellular litter root ecosystem is unoccupied habitat. And for us, for grizzlies to remain demographically and evolutionarily connected, we really need to see all of these populations connected. Next. In 2002, Troy Merrill and Dave Matson completed a grizzly bear habitat effectiveness model. And in this, if you look at the colors, we see that we've got the dark green are designated parks, the light green are grizzly bear source areas, and then we've got transition areas. And when all of the, if you look at the pink lines and the average dispersal distance, the places where we have the best opportunity for connection and grizzly bear connectivity between populations is actually in the panhandle of Idaho and northwest Montana, which is the area that we consider being the Cabinet-Purcell Mountain Corridor. On top of this, in 2005, Michael Proctor completed a genetic analysis that revealed that demographic fragmentation of grizzly bears is real and is a true concern. And as he has quoted here, transborder bear populations may be more threatened than previously thought, and that conservation efforts must expand to include international connectivity management. We use this as the start of the Cabinet-Purcell Mountain Corridor project in partnership with many different agencies and organizations to really begin looking at how, what are the steps that we need to take, what are the goals and actions that we need to take to provide connectivity for grizzly bears, but also many other species in the Cabinet-Purcell Mountain Corridor. Next. And from that grizzly bear model, we partnered closely with Michael Proctor and Wayne Caseworm and Chris Levine, all grizzly bear experts, to figure out where really are the best places for connectivity. We took it from the large-scale models straight down on the ground to look at grizzly bear collar information and movement data. And so based on movement data, this group of people that was not yet considered the Cabinet-Purcell Mountain Corridor collaborative kind of came together to figure out what really are the top priorities. And so here in red, you see very top priority linkages and then other linkage areas. Through a study that American Wildlands did, and they identified over 60 linkages in the Cabinet-Purcell Mountain Corridor that are important for grizzly bear movement. And this effort that actually is mapped here by the Vital Ground Foundation shows a number of those priority linkages in the area that we call the Cabinet Yak, which is a much smaller area within the Cabinet-Purcell. Next. We took all of this information using some of the best science that was available, some of the best habitat models and grizzly bear models that were available, to define our vision and goals. And this is a process where we, again, had many agencies from both Canada and from the U.S., state, provincial, and federal representatives, and then a number of private contractors and NGOs, to really sit down and define what were our vision and goals. Next. And through that process, we defined what was come to be known as a collaborative conservation framework and strategic plan. This took about 2 years to put together, 2.5 years to put together. It started in early 2006 after Michael Proctor's studies and call for transboundary conservation. And it's been our guiding principle or guiding document ever since. Next. So in this, the Cabinet-Purcell Mountain Corridor, or CPMC Collaborative, created a vision. And that vision, as you can read here, is to maintain and restore ecological function at the continental scale so that healthy wildlife populations can remain connected, both geographically and evolutionarily or genetically, to ensure capacity to adapt to climate change and to support thriving communities. Next. We took that to also define what our priority actions would be. Next. And in that process, we identified a total of 8 goals. To start with these, it is most important that we protect core reserves. And these are the areas that are already identified as grizzly bear management units or wilderness areas or national parks throughout the Cabinet-Purcell Mountain Corridor. And we do that specifically, most of those areas are on public land. By the nature of how our public lands are distributed, most of the core grizzly bear habitat is on public lands and managed by federal entities. We also work to secure those linkage zones, knowing that those core areas are not enough to really provide movement and security for grizzly bears. We also need to secure those linkage zones. And we do this by either acquiring private land or working with landowners to create conservation easements or conservation management plans and developing land exchange programs. So the best habitat remains intact with core areas. We also work to restore those linkage zones. And we do this by improving permeability and habitat quality. And so Lacy will tell you soon about and show you some pictures of some of the work that's been happening there to date by decommissioning and recontouring roads and also working to reduce invasive species, and then to, as part of that, also to restore aquatic integrity by reconnecting streams that are often disconnected by failing culverts on old road systems within the Forest Service. Next. Another goal was to mitigate transportation routes across Lincoln Zone. And I'm again going to leave most of our current work with our partners to Lacy to describe later, but this has really become a top priority for us, or one of our top priorities as we gain capacity in the Cabinet-Purcell Mountain Corridor. We also, one of the goals is also to improve existence, coexistence, and to reduce human-bear conflict. And also, another goal is to manage recreation impacts. We're seeing this as in Montana specifically, there was a 150% increase in OHVs between the years of 1990 and 1998, and impacts from recreation are growing in the Cabinet-Purcell Mountain Corridor. Next. And less of goals that are established or carried out by all of our partners, but Y2Y is working to implement this entire adaptive management plan. We also work with groups like the Yak Valley Forest Council to monitor forests, and that needs to happen. So we're constantly using the best scientific knowledge to prioritize those actions. And then finally, we need to make this program sustainable. And so one of the goals in the framework is to ensure that project sustainability by always keeping resources coming to our partners to get great conservation grants work done on the ground. Next. And this is the importance of the collaborative and really having that be kind of the in-between and the group that we go to always check in and make sure that what we're doing relates back to our goals and that our actions will result in implementable projects, and that we're always monitoring those as well to make sure that we're headed in the right direction. Next. So this work is done by over 60 partners. I think that at last count we had 69 partners who have been involved since 2007. And some of these have kind of come and gone as funding has shifted, but for the most part, we're really proud to involve so many nonprofits, so many agencies, but also our First Nations and our tribes. Next. And so the question might be, so what is Y2Y's role in all of this? And not only are we on the ground doing some of the restoration work, but one of our roles is to expand the context of local efforts to a continental scale. I often say that the work of Y2Y is that of a photo mosaic, where every single photo, every single small photo needs to be, has to be in focus. So when you zoom out, we know that we're all part of something bigger. And so that photo would also be fully in focus. And so the work of the local groups is extremely important in building credibility in the community, creating contacts with landowners, and being able to really move forward on locally driven efforts that have impacts at a larger scale. Y2Y is also the primary convener, and we facilitate annual and sometimes biannual partner gatherings. We also commission and support new science. We're often raising funds so we can get the best scientists to research what's happening with species on the ground so we can make the best conservation decisions and have the best conservation outcomes. We're also trying to bring increased funding to the region and also bringing leadership and funding to that conservation work. So often, and you'll see in future slides, we're helping prioritize what those projects might be, and we're also helping to raise funds so those projects come to fruition and help communicate the importance of each of those projects. And then finally, we often provide oversight to restoration and monitoring activities. Next. And this is where I really wish Candace was on the phone. But Candace, did you just show up? We'll see if Candace is here to help participate in this. But we really wanted to highlight the importance of that this is two separate countries and one effort. And that comes with challenges, but it also comes with opportunities. I'm going to be quiet for just a second to see if Candace is able to chime in here.
Hey, Kim, this is Mary. I don't see any. There she is on her microphone. Okay, looks like she should be able to talk. Go ahead, Candace.
Okay. Or not. Hi, Candace. I was hoping you and I could kind of engage in the conversation about the challenges and opportunities ahead for this transboundary project.
Hi, everybody. Sure. So just briefly, we're operating in a transborder context, which, of course, means a lot of transborder species. And particularly, we've been focused on grizzly bears, obviously, but also mountain caribou over time. So you know, we're working in two very different jurisdictions with very different laws, rules, regulations. And one of the things that I've noticed working in the transboundary context, which I've done for the last 25 or so years, is you know, there's a difference in agency capacity, and certainly one of the examples that I could offer on that is, you know, the South Selkirk mountain caribou herd, which is a transboundary mountain caribou herd, probably wouldn't exist today if it hadn't been for U.S. Fish and Wildlife supported transplants back in, I believe it was the early 90s or late 80s. So that's just one example, and I certainly hear it from our side of the border quite a bit. You know, without getting into too much, it would be interesting actually to have a conversation about the difference between the values and the cultures. The American part of the CPMC is the farthest north you can get in the lower 48, and I think that gives rise to a certain culture, whereas here we are in BC, we're kind of in the furthest south that you can get in British Columbia, and it's not like we're in the populated metropolitan areas, but certainly it's perhaps a slightly different vibe, so that's always fun to kind of explore and inquire into.
Next. So we also wanted to talk a little about opportunities, and I think Y2Y is perfectly suited to talk about the opportunities, as we're really lucky to have and fortunate to have staff that live on both the U.S. and the Canada side of the Cabinet-Purcell. Candace, do you want to hit a couple of the other topics that you think might make for good opportunities? I think Candace is struggling to stay on the phone. Sorry. So one of the greatest things about this is that we have great partners on both sides who come at this for the same reason that it creates challenges with values and cultures. We also share a lot of the same vision, and so it's also the same landscape. But we're so fortunate to work with partners who are very committed and are determined to use the best science to make decisions on moving forward on transboundary projects and partnerships. And so it's great that we share that science. Many of the same biologists are working in the U.S. and in Canada throughout the Cabinet-Purcell Mountain Corridor, but we also share that same vision. Next. And with that, kind of working our way through the adaptive management model, we can take those prioritized actions and implement projects on the ground. And with that, I'm going to hand it over to Lacy, the Cabinet-Purcell Mountain Corridor Project Coordinator.
Thanks, Kim.
So if you're not familiar with the law of the jungle, it says that the strength of the pack is the wolf, and the strength of the wolf is the pack. And I think this is a really appropriate analogy for the CPMC collaborative, because we are greater than the sum of our parts, but that sum outcome also depends on the strength of our partners. So I want to talk a little bit about the wolves in our pack. This is a map showing some of the different partner activities and efforts that are happening around the CPMC. There's different icons for different types of activities that we had earlier in the presentation. So one of my favorite partners to work with here is the Friends of Scotchman's Peak Wilderness. And these guys are doing some really amazing things for wilderness designation here in North Idaho. And just to give you a little bit of context, I think Bonner County, Bonner and Boundary County in North Idaho are likely some of the most conservative counties in the U.S. we have an extremely resource-consumptive population here that's very conservative. And it's just amazing what the Friends of Scotchman Peak have been able to do here in this type of political environment. And culture. So you can see in this bottom picture the guy in the middle with the beard, that's Bill Huff, executive director of Friends of Scotchman's Peak. And the really cool thing about that picture is that that's a picture of the Bonner County commissioners that he managed to get to hike up to the top of Scotchman's Peak. And I was really impressed because I live in Bonner County, and I went to go vote this spring, and I was reading the position statements for the people running for county commissioner, and each one of them said that they supported wilderness designation for the Scotchman Peak. And I just think that that's pretty amazing, that that accomplishment in this type of county. The other picture on the top here is a picture of a couple of citizen scientists participating in the MBI project, which is something that I helped run for 5 years. And this is actually one of my favorite parts of that job, was getting pictures back like this. There's some really strong public engagement that the Friends of Scotchman Peak have been able to get going here, and it's just a really, for me personally, it's a really rewarding aspect of this type of work. So another group that we work with is the Yaak Valley Forest Council, and they are located in Yaak Valley, which is in northwest Montana, and their executive director is in the bottom picture there, that's Robin King, and they have done some really amazing work that we have helped fund through the NIFWIF grants that have been awarded in that area. So they've been doing some invasive species removal, habitat restoration, road decommissioning efforts, and also just a lot of really great public outreach, such as the Apple Festival that just happened in Troy a few weeks ago, where citizens are encouraged to pick the apples off of their trees to minimize human attractants for bears that are moving through the valley. And so there's a lot of apple-centered events, and they have just done some amazing public outreach in that area, which is also a pretty conservative area of northwestern Montana. But also, you know, YDY has been a funder and an overseer of many of these efforts, but YDY has also done its own on-the-ground decommissioning efforts. So these are just pictures of roads that we've worked on, and you can see in the picture in the upper right, the roadbed kind of erode over time, leaving habitat that's not really good for wildlife. There's a lot of sediment and streams, and decommissioning efforts are great for reestablishing habitat security for wildlife, and also habitat quality for wildlife. So this is stuff that Y2Y has been participating in on the ground. Another project that Y2Y has helped fund is the Defenders of Wildlife Coexisting Fencing Project, and you can see the map is showing fences that have been installed over the last 5 years up in northwestern Montana and north Idaho. So this program basically gives landowners, compensates landowners for the cost of fencing materials and also provides instruction on how to get these fences set up around different human attractants that people have in their on their property, such as chicken coops, gardens, also do waste disposal sites. So this is really important for keeping bears out of human attractants. And, you know, Michael Proctor and Wayne Caseworm say a lot that, you know, the real problem for bears moving through this ecosystem is the lowland valley bottom areas where they come into contact with the wall of humanity, as Michael Proctor calls it, which is really appropriate. I mean, these are places where there's a lot of people living very rurally, and they have all kinds of things that are attractive to bears. And the problem is that once these bears get rewarded for getting into pig pens or chicken coops, it's a behavior that's really hard to change later. And these bears end up getting removed or euthanized, and it's a pretty significant source of mortality for bears. So some of our other partners on the ground have done some great work with land acquisition in this area. So you can see this is showing North Idaho, Creston, Troy, Libby area. And these are all projects that Y2Y has funded and contributed to. And so in these cases, many of them are outright fee title acquisitions. In other cases, these are environmental easements. So you can see that there's been quite a bit of effort in that area in the CPMC to date. Candace, are you there? I think you were going to take this slide.
Yeah, we could just, thank you. We could just pull out one of those examples, which was the Frog Bear property, which is north of the town of Creston on the BC side. And as you can see here, it's north of Highway 3, and part of adjacent to the Creston Valley Wildlife Center, which is a Ramsar site, an important bird area. And what this shows is grizzly bear movement through this really critical linkage zone. And what I just always find amazing about this is you can see right above, you know, you can see the town of Creston on the highway, and you can see that, you know, there is certain bear, one of these bears was really, really active in and around the area, but still managing to find some habitat security outside that area and be what I guess Michael would call a good bear. So you can see the white circle around Duck Lake, and we worked with the Nature Conservancy of Canada on this particular acquisition, the Frog Bear area, which is actually just to the north of Duck Lake itself, and Y2Y's contribution was, you know, helping to bring all the science together and work with the partners there, and then raise significant funding, $500,000. So, I think it's a good example of you know what good partnerships and good science can bring together. Sorry, and this is just a picture looking down at the actual Duck Lake site, and I honestly, sorry, don't know who that fellow is on the left, but that's Harvey Locke on the right. So looking down at the connectivity area there that we were just talking about.
Yeah, that's Michael Proctor.
Oh. Okay. I'll just carry on. Some other examples. We have a longtime partner in the wonderful group WildSight. There might even be some WildSight people listening in, and wanted to highlight one of the big advocacy campaigns up here in the Purcell Mountains has been protecting the Jumbo Valley from the development of a year-round glacier ski resort. And this is a 23-year battle. But certainly WildSight has played a leading role along with the Tanaha First Nation, the West Kootenai Eco Society, Jumbo Wild Conservation Society, and the West Kootenai Coalition for Jumbo Wild. So we've got some pretty good news. It looks like permanent protection for the Jumbo Valley is on the horizon. The development was turned down last year, legally turned down, and while the proponent could still come forward with a much smaller proposal, it doesn't seem like that's very likely. And so where we are now, as long as things keep going on the same trajectory, is that the Tanaha First Nation is developing a management plan for the area, and so we're very much looking forward to seeing what they come out with, and looking for, you know, to permanently protect the amazing values of the Jumbo Valley, including grizzly bears and cross valley connectivity. And this is a photo. It's one of the few places where you can actually hike up from both sides of the Purcells quite easily. So every year there's an east west hike up into the Jumbo Valley, and this is I believe from this year's east west hike. Thanks. I wanted to talk a little bit also about the Mountain Caribou Project, which is a coalition of, anywhere between 8 and 10 over the years, organizations on both sides of the border. And in 2009, due to the efforts of many years of people involved in the Mountain Caribou Project, we saw 2.2 million hectares of mountain caribou habitat in British Columbia legally protected from logging and associated road building. So that's not just in the CPMC area, of course, but what's germane for us is that included protection for the South Selkirk herd. And what this map shows is those mountain caribou protections. And assuming that your colors and my colors are the same, it's kind of those light purple areas. So you can see the dark purple areas, which are provincial parks and the Purcell Wilderness Conservancy, but in between, all of that additional habitat has also been preserved from logging and road building to support the South Purcell herd. So that's a great example, I think, of cross-border coordination. Some CPMC members and some folks from outside the region as well, some provincial and state-level groups. It was certainly, and I think we'll talk about this a little bit more, but when we had our meeting at Sandpoint, our 10th anniversary meeting, people are still very, very concerned about the state of mountain caribou, and rightly so. They're still in very, very serious trouble. The habitat has not yet recovered to the point where it can sustain the kinds of caribou numbers that we want to see. And so there have been maternity pens and wolf calls and all kinds of other management approaches being tried. So it was certainly really clear that the collaborative sees mountain caribou and caribou protection as a priority for future work together.
Okay, so yes, it's back to me. This is Lacy. We do have some pretty very strong partners doing great work on the ground for conservation. But unless you're happy eating squirrels and beaver, you're going to need some other wolves if you want to take down a bison. So for us, you know, what this means is that we work together as a collaborative to work on projects that require a little bit more coordination and maybe efforts from multiple different angles. So for us, our bison, one of our bisons, is transportation. So you can see that we have a couple of main roads that cut through the CPMC, Highway 3 and Highway 2 on this map. And these roads are very effective in severing
the habitat and wildlife populations from each other. So we have pretty big barrier to connectivity in these highways. And so this is something that we've been working on at Y2Y, and you can see this is kind of a little map that shows our different efforts and where they're at in the process. This kind of requires a lot of different types of effort to really make headway on transportation projects. And we've been working on this throughout the CPMC and in other parts of the Y2Y region. So this is one of the science projects that Y2Y has helped fund. This is output from a crash and carcass analysis that was completed by the Western Transportation Institute. And so basically they took all the crash and carcass data for Highway 2. This is Highway 2 up in northwestern Montana, and it's hard to get a good location on it, but up on the left-hand side is the Idaho border, and then it continues over towards Kalispell on the right-hand side. So this is basically just analyzing the locations of different crash and carcass data from years that were obtained from the Montana Department of Transportation and trying to figure out where the hotspots for those crashes occurred. And because those crashes are involved primarily ungulates, because they're large animals and because they require an accident report and usually some kind of insurance damage, they're heavily skewed towards ungulates. And so what they did to compensate for that was take locations of other species and try to overlay that with the analysis output. So this is kind of the first step in trying to achieve wildlife mitigation for transportation corridors, is first determining where are the places that we really need to focus our efforts. We've also been a part of the Roadwatch BC app, which is a really great app that encourages citizen input, and basically it's something that you can use on your phone, and while you're driving, while you're a passenger and someone else is driving, you can log the locations of animals and roadkill that you see along the road. And this is a really great way to get information from the public, because it's one of the things that is seriously lacking in our efforts to create wildlife mitigation along transportation routes is actual data on where animals are getting hit. So as I mentioned, the crash and carcass data tend to heavily favor large animals because that's what insurance companies usually pay out for. That's what a report will entail, but there's a lot of other smaller animals that get hit that are often just unreported, and those tend to be animals that in the conservation community we're a little bit more concerned about. So lynx, wolverine, animals like that just don't go reported. So getting the public's involvement with reporting roadkill is incredibly beneficial for identifying problem areas along roads. So this is kind of our dream for the CPMC and for other areas that we're working on, is we would love to get some animal overpasses like this one outside of Banff. This is kind of the gold standard for highway mitigation. There's also a lot of efforts to implement culvert underpass crossings, but research is showing that these overpasses are very effective in allowing animals to safely cross the road. So if we evaluate our efforts to date and look at the progress we've made, we have a lot of progress in the number of bears that are inhabiting the Cabinet Yak area. A recent DNA analysis survey found about 50 bears in the Cabinet Yak, which is up from about 10 that were there years ago. We've made a lot of progress in the amount of bear-proof food canisters and electric fences that are out on the landscape to minimize the ability for bears to get into trouble. There's been a lot of progress in the number of miles that we've closed to motorized vehicles, and also the amount of forest roads that have been decommissioned and restored. So we're in the process of thinking about what's next for the collaborative. And so one of the things we'd really like to do is get some of the partners together and really think about the conservation framework that was last updated, I believe, in 2008, and try to really relook at some of those goals and objectives and determine if those are things that we still want to focus on or if they need to be changed a little bit to reflect newer issues. We also would like to move beyond grizzly bears to focus on more of a multi-species effort. Specifically mountain caribou, as Candace mentioned, are definitely in need of some focus of conservation efforts. And as Kim mentioned earlier in the talk, there's been a significant increase in the amount of recreation, motorized recreation that's happening on the forest in this region. So that's definitely something that we're going to need to tackle. We'll also be developing a communications plan. And one of the goals of Y2Y is to, and this partnership, is to raise the profile of all of our partners in the area. And we'll be trying to get the 2017 partner meeting organized for next spring. So those are all things that I'll be reaching out to the partners on here fairly shortly. Did you guys have anything else to add?
Not from here. I guess we'll take questions.
Yeah, so this is Mary, and for you folks out in the audience, feel free to type in questions to the presenters. You can do that by just going to that questions pod and typing them in. Also, if you'd like to ask a question via mic or telephone, all you need to do is raise your, there's an icon, I think, to the icon tool next to your name, and you can just raise your hand, and then I can unmute you. So we'll take a couple minutes or a minute or so and get some, see if anybody has any questions. Lacy, this is Mary. Do you guys have any idea where the meeting would be happening next spring? Have you narrowed it down to any one community?
Well, this spring we had it in Sandpoint, which worked great for me because I live here. But I'm definitely open to suggestions. If people want to have it in, we could possibly do it in Canada. Maybe we could have it at Candace's house. And Nelson, I was thinking that'd be a good venue.
Great.
It wouldn't be big enough for the level of for the amount of participation that we hope to have. But certainly, in previous years, we've alternated between the U.S. and Canada. It can be a little bit problematic for U.S. folks sometimes, as my understanding. When we surveyed people after Sandpoint, most people said Sandpoint was probably the best place as being the most central for the most folks. So not trying to shirk hosting. If that happens, that would be great, but it may well be in Sandpoint again.
Okay, we do have one question that came in. The question is from Christine. Have you worked with Defenders of Wildlife on the Rock Creek Montanor mining projects in the cabinets?
That might be one. Kim, are you still on the line? Do you know much about the Rock Creek mine?
I'm sorry, I was on mute. I was just talking away over here. I'm so sorry. Yes, the answer is we are paying attention to it. We haven't actively engaged in it, but we've been talking to a number of partners, including the Montana Wilderness Association and Defenders of Wildlife. This is a project that plans to mine under the existing Cabinet Wilderness area. Lacy and I, along with some of our partners, including Defenders, no, I guess Defenders wasn't on the flight, but we flew over the Montanora site in June. So we're following it. We have not actively participated to date.
Thank you. Next question is from Carl. Will there be an emphasis on recruitment of small landowner conservation easements in the Cabinet Yak?
Good question. I think we might have a conservation easement donor on the phone. We work very closely with, specifically with Vital Ground in the Cabinet Yak. And we are working right now specifically with Vital Ground on acquiring a 19-lot subdivision, which is smack dab in the middle of one of the most important priority corridors for grizzly bear movement along from the Yak Mountains to the Kootenai River. So we are working very strategically on projects that we would raise funds for, and we've worked to identify projects building off of the Anderson property, or what they call the Yak Mountain property, to put together kind of a bigger conservation matrix in that grizzly bear corridor.
Carl just added a note here saying the Berg homestead fifth generation. Does that make sense to you?
I'm sure it does. That's not at the level that we're working on some of these projects. So I'm sure that that does to Vital Ground, and I'd be happy to make those connections. But I'm pretty sure that that the project that he's referring to is under conservation easement with Vital Ground.
All right. The next question is from Chloe. She's curious about how the U.S. Endangered Species Act has impacted the work south of the border, as well as any state endangered species laws. The organization she works for is campaigning for endangered species law in British Columbia, which is currently lacking.
Candace, do you want to take that?
Well, it seemed to be a question about how the ESA is being applied in the U.S., so it seems to be a U.S. question, although I'm very familiar with the, in fact, I was one of the people who started that campaign all too long ago. It's really quite a travesty that British Columbia does not have an Endangered Species Act, and in fact, I was thinking about it driving over here today that British Columbia has this branding of being the best place on Earth, and we riffed off that by saying it was the last place on Earth to not have an endangered species law. So that's certainly something we could use in British Columbia, and I'm glad to hear you're working on that. But in terms of how the ESA has benefited species in the U.S., I would defer to one of our U.S. folks.
I think the ESA has been a great tool. I'm based down in Drakes, Idaho. I'm in the Greater Yellowstone ecosystem and the High Divide, and we look at the progress that we've made with the grizzly bears in the Yellowstone ecosystem, and that population would not have recovered the way it did without Endangered Species Act protection. We're seeing similar results up in the Cabinet Yak, where these populations, we wouldn't be able to augment populations, and they wouldn't be protected without ESA. We know that it's human, it's most of the deaths are human caused mortality, and therefore the ESA has worked very effectively in restoring these populations.
And I would actually I referred earlier to mountain caribou augmentation that happened, and that is an example of a transborder species directly benefiting on both sides of the line from the ESA.
Yeah, I would add that I think that the ESA definitely brings a lot of money to species work, but I think there can also be a downside in a couple of different respects. So one of the issues up here in North Idaho is that we have a lot of the Forest Service has put up a lot of gates for endangered species. And like grizzly bear, and they also have a lot of winter travel restrictions for caribou, and that's really engendered a lot of resentment from the local community. So I think, you know, that's one of the potential downsides. I think the other thing is that a lot of times listing designation can, in a way, almost inhibit collaboration when working on these species, because things get very litigious. So for example, I used to work for the state of Idaho, and you know, we worked with Canada Lynx up in North Idaho, and that was something that we really couldn't collaborate with people with our partners on, because it was so litigious that we couldn't really even say or do anything or share information. So it kind of became a hindrance in a sense. So I think that there are two sides to the ESA in my experience.
Thank you. One last question. It's another question from Chloe. She's also wondering about the purchases in the Flathead Valley, which Y2Y facilitated for Tech Mining. How has it been working with a mining company? Is that a sustainable strategy in terms of long-term habitat wilderness protection?
Well, certainly securing those lands, yeah. I mean, actually having fee simple conservation lands, you know, in some cases can be some of the strongest protection. And certainly, you know, my understanding of how those lands are being managed is that the management is quite good there. You know, it's only one piece of the conservation puzzle. You know, it's one tool in the toolbox, so to speak. But you know, it's interesting to see some of the pieces falling together there. You know, some of the lands that Tech has purchased, and others have purchased through the Elk Valley, is now leading to you know, there's more wildlife. That means there's more wildlife on the road on both sides of those valleys. So we talked about the Road Watch application and our efforts to improve highway and wildlife collision safety on Highway 3, and Tech is also a big supporter of that, because you know, they want to protect the wildlife that's moving back and forth between the conservation lands that they've invested in. So you know, it can work really well, and it's just, you know, one arrow in the quiver.
Thank you. Well, it looks like that's it for the questions, and we're just about out of time. Lacy, Kim, or Candace, any last minute words that you want to share with the group, or are we ready to end the session?
I'm good. Candace or Kim, did you have anything?
I would just thank everybody for participating today, and my apologize for my lateness. I had technical issues, and hope to see many of you at our next gathering.
Great.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you to everyone who participated today, and thanks to all of our great partners out in the CPMC as well. We couldn't, none of this would be possible without really strong partnerships.
Yeah.
Great. Thank you, Kim, Lacy, and Candace for presenting today. It was very informative. And I'd also like to thank our audience, of course, for attending today. Just one final note for those who came in late, we always, as I said in the beginning, we do record the webinar, and we'll have that link to that recording as well as a PDF of the slides available to you sometime next week. So with that being said, I just want to wish everybody a wonderful day, and we'll hopefully see you on our next webinar. Goodbye.